That's just a heads up. So from eGov, this is Omkar. I kind of manage enablement for our partner-led programs. Okay. I have with me Elzam. Elzam, she heads all our implementation projects in various states. Then I have Pradeep. Pradeep is the tech manager for BPA, OBPass, and EDCR. I have Shankar, who's the product owner and manager for EDCR. And I have Vinod. Vinod is part of Pradeep's team. Okay. So I will request someone from Intellace to quickly introduce the team, and then we can go ahead.
Okay, and this is Vijay from Interlace, and with me and Vimal and Arulasan and Ilanjan, she is a developers, and Raji is a IT manager, and Shivabalan is from CAD specialist.
Thanks, thanks, Vijay.
Yes.
Welcome, all of you. I also see PRK joining in. Hi, PRK.
Morning, morning,
Okay.
Omkar.
Hi, morning. We were just beginning PRK doing introductions, so
Yeah.
welcome. Pradeep, Shankar, over to you guys. Thank you.
Yeah, hi everyone. Pradeep?
Yes, Shankar, go ahead.
Okay. So to start with, I can give you the overview of the module. Looks like most of you were there in the old demo session, which was given some time ago for OBPA. But anyway, I'll showcase it again. So if there is any doubts, you can stop me anywhere and then ask questions. It will take another 15 to 20 minutes.
Okay.
Sangit, just one thing. PRK, before we begin, you want to address the team?
No, Shankar will give an introduction. We don't need any introduction, I think. We
No,
already
not
talked.
introduction. Just
Let us
I
get
mean,
started.
they're just going to begin the program, so I mean, at your auspicious hands, we want
Okay, I'll do that.
Auspicious voice.
Thanks, Omkar. Shanavas. Okay. Shanavas. Okay. So you all know about BPA, right? It is not like any other municipal domain product or a generic workflow product. It has one unique feature, which is called DCR scrutiny. That is the highlight of this product, actually. And so far in India, one leading player in this field is Auto DCR, and by Softec. That is one product which is on a proprietary source. And this Digit DCR is the only application available in India in a completely open source and open standard format. So it has a lot of potential for marketing, as well as states are in dire need of this solution, actually. To understand better, software domain alone will not be sufficient here. You need to have a team or some resource who has a basic understanding of an architecture, building, plans, engineering, design. This kind of exposure will always be as an added value to your team. I don't think so far people would have been highlighting about this, but knowing about the plan and the development control rules and what is the normal process in which the planning approval is being applied across the states are all key essential details which you need to be aware of before getting into this domain on a technical front. What else to be added? Most of the things will be handled by Shankar and Pradeep. These are just few words here. Anything specific you want from me, Shanavas? They are not okay.
No, Shankar. I think that's
thanks, Shankar. Go ahead.
Yeah. Omkar, also we need a little bit about audience actually who are all joined. Whether one more company is also joined.
Yeah,
right? Amtex today.
Yes. So I think from Amtex, Mr. Shanavas has joined. Can you hear us, Shanavas? Hello.
Shanavas.
Hi all, this is Balasubramaniam. I'm not sure whether Shanavas got busy with another call. I'm also from Amtex Systems. So we are looking at just having a walkthrough on the EDCR.
Great. Okay. So Balasubramaniam, anyone else from your team has joined? Just wanted to check.
No other as well. No.
Okay.
Shankar, I just want see since this is purely a technical session, the resources who are going to work on this project, if they are in this call, that would be mostly beneficial.
They are PRK. So from IntelliS side, their dev team is part of the conversation. So Amtex team is here just to kind of get a feel of how it is done, but our main agenda is to enable the IntelliS team. So from their side, we have all their tech folks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Murugan is there, right?
Murugan is delayed. He'll be joining in another 10 minutes, I think.
Okay.
Okay, Shankar, over to you. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks, Omkar. Thanks, Pierre. Okay. So to start with, so I'm not showing any PPTs. I'm just directly going to the module. Okay. So as we all know, we have already seen it. We have already known the benefits of the module. I'm just directly jumping into the flow. So to do an EDCR scrutiny, the architect or the technical person should be a registered person in the ULP. So I'm just logging in as a person who is already registered in the system. Okay, so I'm just logging in and the architect is already registered. And so based on the roles that is assigned to this particular user, you are seeing the menu tree links on the left panel. And he contains both EDCR scrutiny as well as a building plan approval application flow. And so click on EDCR scrutiny. With two simple steps, you can do the diagram scrutiny. Yeah. So you can see new building plan scrutiny, scrutiny for occupancy certificate, and my applications. So new building plan scrutiny will scrutinize the diagram for construction of a new building, where OC occupancy certificate EDCR will do the scrutiny for the occupancy certificate diagram scrutiny, where it will take a reference from the existing building permit diagram. Then it will compare with the new diagram that is actually new diagram with actual construction, and then we'll generate a comparison report as well as the EDCR scrutiny. So this is the second service, and my application will give me the list of applications that I have scrutinized so far. Because I'm an architect, I can scrutinize hundreds of applications for different clients, right? So this my application will give me a view of list of applications that I have scrutinized so far in a table report, so that I can understand I have done the scrutiny for different clients like Shankar and Jyoti and Yusuf and Sanji. So this is a useful table format where I can understand what was the report that was uploaded and what is the output that I got and what is the status of it. And so I'm just going for the new building plan scrutiny right now. Then I need to select the city. Since it is statewide implementation, I need to select the city which I want to do the scrutiny. So I'm selecting the city. And just for the reference, I'm just entering the applicant name. So I'm just going to upload a file which is in the DXF format, and so this is the diagram which I'm going to upload. This diagram is drawn with the e-government's standard digit standards for EDCR with the layer names and color coding standards. This is a simple residential single floor building which is constructed, and then I'm going to upload this diagram and then generate a scrutiny report out of it. uploading a file. So if you click on submit, what will happen is system will extract the parameters from the diagram. Then it will validate the extracted parameters with that of the bylaw that is configured in the backend. Then it will throw in output report, whether it is accepted or rejected. If it is accepted, it will generate a unique reference number. If it is rejected, it will throw an error saying that it is rejected. And it will allow the user to correct the mistakes, and then again, we can iteratively upload the diagram and then get an output report. I'm clicking on submit now. Okay, so it says building plan EDC scrutiny is accepted. It contains an application number as well as a unique DCR reference number. With this reference number, I can create a building permit application. Or in fact, if I want to change something, I can very well change the diagram and then re-upload it again. You'll see the report. You can see the reports from the download icon here. So this is the scrutiny output, and this is just a PDF generator. You can generate whichever format you want to generate. And it contains the QR code, where scanning this QR code will give you a primary information about the status, the unique reference number, and the city. So, and the list of parameters also can be changed as you need. And in the list of, you can see the information that is getting populated from the diagram. So if everything is getting populated from the diagram, including the Aadhaar number, area of the plot, built-up area, road where, except the applicant name, Elzan, which I have entered in the flow. So these are all the declarations in the drawing. So as per the digit standard, they have added the declaration in the declaration layer, so that is getting populated in the PDF report. And overall summary gives me what is the built-up area, road area, carpet area, and we'll have a block-wise information. So if the diagram contains multiple blocks, then it will have block number, block 1, block 2, block 3, and it will have a block-wise summary, like the table given below. And the table will be like array of tables for each and every block. And for each and every rule that is configured, you will have a separate grid card. Like fire, you have a card. For government building business, you have a card. For green buildings, you have a different card. So in each of the card, you can see the bylaw number. So this is the bylaw number that is configured for the particular state. And also it populates the occupancy type from the diagram itself. And it says what is the permissible value, less than or equal to 1.2, and provided value is 0.15. That is the reason why it is accepted. If it is rejected, the same will have a different value, which is violating to the permissible limits. So this is basically the report output. And in fact, if there are other ways of rejections also. So there are cases where they wouldn't have followed the digit standard, they wouldn't have drawn the color coding and layering, they wouldn't have followed proper color coding and naming standard. In that case also, it will fail. In those cases, these tables will not be visible, and it will just simply say the layer names was not right, the overhead hanging was not right, and the floor area layer was not right. Those kind of valid information will come in so that the user can go to the particular layer alone in the diagram and then correct the diagram. It is that user friendly. So once you start testing the diagrams, you will come to know those things. And the flow, So I can just simply go to the create application from the EDC flow, just creating an application. Now what happens is the information that is there in the diagram is getting pulled to the application flow. And the main thing is whatever the information that is getting pulled from the diagram, you can modify that in the application. So that's a validation here. And so whatever information that I cannot or would not be able to get it from the diagram itself, so I'm asking the user to enter those information in the application flow. So I'm just entering some information which is not added in the diagram. And the next stepper will tell me an abstract view of the information that is present in the diagram, like occupancy, sub-occupancy, build-up area, floor area, carpet area. And in one building, there can be multiple sub-occupancies. There is an option to update the sub-occupancies here, so that you also know what is occupancy as well as the sub-occupancies. And you click on next step, it redirects me to the owner page, owner of the building, where I can select whether the owner is an individual, private or government. This is a standard digit component, which is used across different modules. So, and in owner, so it can be a single owner or multiple owners. If it is multiple owner, you can see this card getting repeated again and again so that you can add multiple owners here. So here I can create a new user. If I enter a new mobile number, what happens is after entering applicant name, gender, email, date of birth, and relationship, if I click on next step, internally it will create a owner in the system. Or if I enter a mobile number where the owner is, where the citizen profile is already present in the system, it will fetch those information to populate here. So I'm just entering the owner information is already present. And then clicking on next step. So this step gives me the document and NOC detail. This document and NOC list is completely configurable based on city to state, so that if one city wants a different set of documents and NOC detail, that can be completely configured. And this NOC detail is configured based on the building height and the risk type. If the risk is low and building height is so and so, and if it is falling in certain zoning regulation that is populated in the diagram, then you can configure for this particular combination of zoning regulation and building height. You can say fire NOC is mandatory, airport NOC is mandatory, national monument authority is mandatory. So that information will get populated. That's how it is configured here, where the building height is more than 10 meters and AI is mandatory. And fire NOC is like basically mandatory for all the applications here. That's how it is configured. But you can change the configuration as you need. I'm just uploading some files, document that are mandatory. And so this is multiple attachment. You can add n number of attachments here. Usually it will be on the ground into multiple documents, because title deed of property will be like huge number of pages. And so as you can see, three applications numbers are present here. One is 99 and other one is 86 and 87. So one application is getting poked into three applications here, one for Airport Authority, one for Fire and OC, and one for the department itself. So this is the kind of integration what we have done and did it. And I'll explain the details in the flow. Right now, just understand that one application is getting poked into three different applications. And in case there are some applicants who knows that there are certain NOCs that are required, they just go to the department directly, submit the information, and then get the NOCs. If that is the case, we are providing an option for the applicant citizen to upload the NOCs here directly. Okay, so and that is not a mandate that the ULB will accept this upload. Anyway, they will validate this upload, they will cross check with the department and check the authenticity of it, and then upload the application. But there's an option for the citizen to upload the NOCs if they already have it in mind. And okay, so this fee estimate is also configurable for the city. If the city doesn't want the fee, doesn't have an application fee itself, you can remove the script. And from the summary, you can edit the application and then go to the direct step first to which you want to modify the application. And then come back and then save the application flow. And apart from that, you can send it. The flow is like, as an architect, I'm creating something and now I am forwarding this to the citizen to get his concurrence, so the citizen can know that what is that architect has created in the application and submitted in the diagram. So now I'm sending it to the citizen. And yeah, now the application is sent to the citizen. I'm logging out from the architect and then logging in as a citizen now. As you can see, there are notifications on the right top corner. So I'm getting email notifications saying that application is submitted, and then I can log into the portal and then check the status. I'm logging in as a citizen. It's in building plan approval application. So it will be in my application space. So as you can see, the difference in layout. So for an architect, my application is a table layout, whereas for a citizen, it is a card layout. It is purposely done like that because the architect has to handle hundreds of applications whereas a citizen it is one or two. And you can see the status of citizen approval pending. As a citizen, what I can do is I can view the information, I can ask the architect to make some corrections in the flow, or I can simply say I completely agree, and then I am approving the architect to forward the application to the next level. So I'm just forwarding to the architect saying that I'm approving it. So now I'm logging out from citizen, logging in as an architect to process the application or submit the application. Plan approval, my application. So now I can submit the application to the UI. So since it has got an application field, I need to make the application field, make payment. It goes to the common collections page of Digit, where I can select what mode of payment it is. Selecting card. So on success, I'll receive a success message as well as the receipt format that can be downloaded. So there is a success message, receipt number is present, and then I can download the receipt artifact from this place. Now I need to go to the employee side. So the flow is like in the application flow, there is a first document scrutiny. There are like 8 or 9 documents that was uploaded, right? There is a document upload, document scrutiny in the first step. So if there is any clarifications or a problem in the document, it can be very well rejected. Then the next step is like field inspection report. The field inspector goes to the ground and do the field inspection. And the third step is the no objection certificate verification. And the fourth step is the actual approval. And now I logged in as a I'm logging in as a document verifier who can verify the documents. Filtering it based on the model name. 99 is application number. See, as a document verifier, I can do two things. I can ask the citizen to get more information. I can simply take an action, send back to the citizen, okay, asking for more information, or I can simply reject it. Or in case this is a physical verification, right? The citizen is coming with a bulk of documents, and assume that the employee identifies that there is some document that is present with the citizen that is useful for the application, he can very well upload it. So there is an upload option for the document verifier as well, so that it's easy for him to just scan on the ground and then upload it to the system. That's why you can see the upload buttons for each and every document that is configured here. And apart from that, I can send back to the citizen asking for more information, or I can simply reject it. So now I'm forwarding to the next user saying that everything is in order. You can see 99, this is the application. As a field inspector, So the thing is, like, you can update the field inspection report, field inspection date and time, and to benefit the user on the ground. So this is typically the field inspection is happening on the ground real time in a mobile phone, right? So it will be difficult for the user to type some information. That's the reason why we have configured the list of checklist for this particular field inspection feature, where this checklist detail can be modified from state to state, configured from state to state, so that you can have n number of questions as per the state need. And you can have a values yes, no, or no applicable, or not applicable, so that it is easy for the user on the ground to select in the mobile phones. And if at all he wants to add some remarks, he can use the remarks feature here to add some remarks there. And apart from that, he can take some photograph, upload some documents, and it is multiple. In most cases, we have seen a handbook that they carry where they note some information on the ground. So they can upload the photograph of those handbooks as well. And they can also upload the site images. So this is very important because they take site image on all sides of the site. We have provision for that also. And this list also is configurable, so you can configure the list. For some reason, the system is or internet, I'm not very sure. It's very slow. Yeah. So, and add another field inspection report. This is important because, so today I went for the field inspection report. I'm not satisfied with the inspection. And again, I want to go to the field and do one more field inspection report. I can use this feature. And assume that I forward this application to the next higher level officer, and that officer is not convinced or find some flaw in the flow. And he's redirecting the field inspector to do one more field inspection report. In that case also, you can add multiple field inspection reports so that you get a satisfactory output. So that's the reason we have a multiple field inspection report option here. And so this is pretty much the function of a field inspection report. And I can forward this to the next level, or I can simply send back to this and all for asking for more information, or simply reject the application. So the next is the no objection certificate verification. Yeah, basically he can see the inspection report, he can see all the details, and the main purpose is like he has to update the no objection certificate. So the no objection certificate integration is done in like two ways in Digit. There are three ways actually. The first way is like API integration. If there is a system in place and if the NOC department is willing to share APIs, that's the best way to, ideal way to do it. Where you have an API integration, you just send the information and then get it back. So that integration is not done yet, but the API capability is present. And the second way of integrating is that we are providing a login option for the third party department to log into the digital system. And then you can take a look at the application which is submitted for a fire NOC or whichever NOC department. Then he can download the application, process the application manually in his department, and when there is a process end, whether it is accepted or rejected, when there is an outcome, he can come back to this particular login. He can say for against a particular application 99 or XYZ, he can say the NOC is approved or rejected. And as a proof, he can update the approval or rejection letter along with it. So that gets reflected in this space, so that the ULB or department ETCP official can understand that the fire NOC department has processed the application and he has either rejected it or approved it. That's the second integration. And the third way is like, and the department itself is not willing to log into the application, but everything will be done manually. The ULB department or the DTCP department guy has to talk to the NOC department person, get the information manually, and then he can upload the only the output, whether it is accepted or rejected letter in the upload feature that is given here. So there are three ways of doing it. I'll just showcase you the second case where a fire department or NOC department may log into the application, use the application, process it manually, and then you can update the outcome of it. So I'm just logging out from the NOC verifier. So just note down the status here. The status says in progress and it says submitted on so and so date and time. Now I'm logging out from this user and logging in as a Fire NOC user to process the application. We'll put an outcome there so that we can see the status change in the NOC verifier log. We're logging in as a Fire NOC user. Okay, so it's a localization issue. Status is it is initiated. It contains an application number. The most important thing is source module. Source module says building plan approval. So the Fire NOC user can understand that this particular application is for building permit approval. And then you can view the reference BPA application. So redirect street user to the reference BPA application. We can see the entire details. So from top to bottom, you can see field inspection report documents attached, because he also needs to know the entire application to process in his department side. So post processing, we can again log in and come back to the screen, and then you can take an action, upload. You can say upload a file saying that this is an approval letter or something. And you can see the status is approved or rejected. So I'm approving it. So now this status change will reflect in the Fire NOC, NOC user of the ULP. So now you can see the status is approved and approved or rejected on so and so. There is a unique reference number, reference approval number that got generated for this. And it also says who uploaded the file and when and what date it was uploaded. So that the department user can download this file and see, okay, there is a rejection letter, there is an approval letter. This application is good to go. You can take a decision on with respect to the information presented here. Now I can simply forward this application to the next level saying that everything is in order so that the approver can take a decision. Now I'm logging out and logging in as an approver. You can approve the building permit application. So as an approver, I can view the documents, I can see the field inspection report, I can view the NOC detail. Then there are important information that I can add the permit condition. So this permit condition is also configurable for a state. And so the important feature to note here is the ad hoc permit condition that can be entered by the approver. See, from the experience what we had, even though you have an exhaustive list of permit conditions, based on case basis, there will be definitely some condition that needs to be added on the fly. That's the reason we have an ad hoc permit conditions here, so that it is easy for the user to add some conditions that is unique for a particular building. Now I can say simply approve. If there is a amount that needs to be paid for the building permit, the backend calculator will run, it will generate a demand, and it will get notified to the citizen. So now I need to log in either as a citizen or an architect to make the building permit. So I'm logging in as an architect. So you can see 99 application status is pending for sanction fee payment. So once I make the fee for the sanction payment for the sanction fee, I can download the permit order. You can see there is a make payment button here. it goes to the collections page. They can make collections for 500 and then download the permit order. The permit order will have information of whatever that was entered in the application, like owner name, address, what is the built-up area, floor area, carpet area, and permit conditions. Yeah, you can download the permit order as well as the receipt for the final request payment. So now you can see, and this is also a PDF generator. You can customize the PDF as you need. And this is the standard content format what we have. It will have address, it will have the permit conditions. So this was the ad hoc condition that I was talking about. And it will have details of total fee that is being. There is an application fee of 120, sanction fee of 500, total 620 years paid. And validity period. This is an important information to note in a permit order where he has to complete the construction of the building within this stipulated time. So post which either he has to go for one more application or he has to revise this. And there is a QR code scanner which gives basic details of the application as well. That's it. So this is the flow of a EDSA scrutiny as well as a billing permit order. Any doubts? Okay, I'll take this as a no doubt. Pradeep, what do you?
Yeah. Team, it's better if you have any doubts, please raise, okay? It's not like a, it should be an interactive section, actually. Any doubts, please stop us and ask us, okay? And so this main reason for this session is to clarify all our doubts and everything. Thanks, Shankar. Okay, I'll proceed now. See, the overall, Shankar gave an idea about why we gave the product demo is we want you to give the overall picture of this application, actually. As a part of Tamil Nadu Fender, they are saying only they want EDCR scrutiny as a integration is required. That's it. But we try to show you the end-to-end functionality also. So, you know, which are, how much work is also required in each entire end-to-end functionality. Okay, the today's agenda is as per the plan. 1 minute, I'll share my screen. Okay. See, so it's already 11:40. I'll go quickly, actually. So the plan today is, today overall, we'll cover the entire DCR part, how what's the role of architect and what he need to do actually, and how much work is required to convert these DCR rules into our formats, all those things. We will discuss about all these points today. So I'll explain you now how it is working actually. What Shankar showed, right? There is a diagram. The diagram he submitted and some output you got immediately. So what happened actually? So the point here is what happened when a user submits, how it works, all those things we'll discuss now. And what are the prerequisites for the software to run actually? Those kind of basic information about EDCR, all those things we'll discuss in the first half. In the second half, we'll discuss about, we have something called template actually, how to convert our rules into that format. Those kind of things we'll discuss in the second half actually. Okay. Yes, as I suggested, if you have any doubts, you please stop me.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so, yeah. So, as we said, so each municipality, if you go, I'll come up with some basic information also. In each city, if you consider, there are different set of rules they are following, actually. Example, if it's a statewide, normally each state has its own thereof building bylaws. If you see here, in the Tamil Nadu, I'm just searching, there are different type of building bylaws are defined. Actually, each panchayat, you have a different role. There are different financial year-wise. Example, 72, you have something, 83, you have something, 97, you have something. There are different building bylaws, okay? That they are defining for overall period, they are doing amendments, everything, and some rules they define for building plan approval system. So building plan approval system, when you're defining all these things, the main intention of the government is, see, when you're constructing any building, it should not, you should get a proper air and light, everything, and you should not disturb any neighbors. Okay, for that, and safety of the safety. These are the three, four major things that, keeping in mind, they are defining all these rules. Whenever you are going to apply for any building, so first they will check whether are you following a set of parameters that we define in a rule. Okay, what is this rule actually? The rules are like example, setback. Setback is one of the things where I am saying you need to give all the four sides this much space is required. So these rules they define for each step of building. If you are saying a residential building, what is the rule? Commercial, what is the rule? They define like this. And there is a height restriction. You can't construct something very big, higher building in some particular area. Those kind of restrictions, while looking the safety, everything, they define the rule actually. Okay. Now, those things, so how normally what happens is whenever you want to construct any house, you're going and approaching the architect. Architect, you are saying, okay, I need construction of this building in this particular form. And based on that, he is designing your building. And he will check whether is it satisfying all the bylaws of the concerned state or a particular city. That is very important. Why I'm saying city here is, each city also has sometime example in corporations, they have their own set of bylaws actually. They may amendment to your state bylaws. They may add additionally some more parameter. Example, I can force my all Chennai places wherever who are constructing more than two floor, solar is mandatory. They can declare like that. So that decision they can taken by the corporations also. So they are specific to a city also, there are some rules. Come to state-wise, as we said, state defining some set of rule. On top of that, national building bylaws. National building bylaws defined already at national level, how and what for each occupancy, what are the different type of, what are the limitations actually. When I'm coming to the occupancy, the major concept of any building is, What type of living you are doing there? What type of business you are doing or usage you are doing there? It matters. So major thing is like residential buildings, commercial building, industrial building. These are the top level. Okay, so these are the more than 80% building bylaws or permissions were is most of them are residential buildings. Cases like there may be a commercial buildings also. There are industrial building, educational building, hazardous buildings. These are the different buildings permissions we need to give in the system, actually. So that, so overall, and there are maybe in one building itself, I have a different type of blocks are there. Example, in case of apartment, they are constructing block one, yeah, block two, block three, like that. So what are the rules applicable at each stage is important. Like when I'm saying residential plus commercial, and my ground floor is a commercial building, first floor is my residential. Now, the rules applicable is entirely different than if it is entirely a residential building. So any doubts here? I'm going to halt for a few seconds here. Guys, you are following me, any doubts here?
No, sir, I have not. I don't have doubts.
Okay, see, the why I'm saying all these basic things is, I included developer also here. When you're coding, you need to know all these basic things actually. When you are getting any diagrams of both combinations, like residential plus commercial, how the system should automatically scrutinize that drawing is important. How you are going to handle. if the occupancy types are only commercial, what are the rules, how you are handling those logics, we need to scrutiny when we are doing that is very important. So it's better to understand the basics, then it is easy to coding actually.
Okay.
So next one, so as Shankar explained, there are when I'm scrutinizing also, there are some set of parameters. Example, we'll see any one drawing which is already present.
Pradeep, you are on mute if you are speaking.
Yeah. Okay. See the output, what I'm showing here. See what we did, nothing we did actually. See, in the sense, drawing we defined, we just uploaded. Automatically, we got all this information in the output, right? So nowhere we feeded any data. When Shankar first screen he utilized, scrutinized that drawing, just he uploaded one drawing, he entered the applicant name, that's it. And this is the output we got. So how, what is this content of this output is very important. See, nowhere we added what type of occupancy, what type of who is a technical person or who is the applicant, what kind of service type, these kind of things, okay? Plot number, MOUSA, overall weight. See, these are all, nowhere I selected or entered through UI. Just added a drawing, I got this output, okay? So how it is happened? So second part, Shankar mentioned, it's a declaration part. So where is declaration? I just gave something like, what is declaration like if your building is near to the government? These details somewhere we are capturing in the drawing itself. We'll discuss about that, how we captured this drawing declarations. Third part is, so as a, there are some plot details, declarations, and overall summary we gave. Example here we said it's a only one block is there, it contains 51 meters, and as we are going through some common scrutiny data. What is this common is, there are some rules which are applicable on the entire plot level, right? The plot level in a sense, for based on your entire plan, I'm just checking whether, take an example, whether your plot is next to any government building. Because in the top they declared yes, then there is some rules we are checking, whether it is minimum 200 meters from that distance is there or not. Let's think, if I am not defined this in the plan, what happens is, I'm just showing an error saying that, okay, you declared you are nearer to the government building, yes, but you are not showed that details in the diagram. So we have an error section where we are showing this, and the entire application is not accepted here. See, so we are not stopping, like we are not checking one by one. We are checking the entire rule, and we are showing where all errors are there. We are showing which is not accepted or accepted in the drawing itself. So in this way, one shot applicable rules we are showing, and also we are showing what is missing in the drawing. So these are the common things. It's a floor area ratio. The floor area ratio of the entire building at the plan level, what is permissible and what is provided, and based on that we are deciding. So this is a combination here. So based on the area of the type, based on the road width, I calculated my floor area ratio. The bylaw says it should be less than or equal to 1.2, but he's called it 0.15. Okay. Similarly, I'm showing some more things, whether I have near to monument, it declared yes. So I'm just adding those things, the distance. So there are, the parking is not any block specific. Overall, for this particular plan, based on the area, I'm displaying the parking, rainwater, organization, these things. We are showing block wise now. Why it is block is, so the rules, what is pure at the plan level or entire building or overall area wise. Second one is each block wise. When I'm coming to building wise, I'm checking set of rules for each building, whether I have all the four side, front, rear side, we have provided setback or not. And there are stairs, green planting strip, these kind of height of the building, number of floors, plinth. So what I'm trying to tell you here is system will automatically identify what are the rules required for this kind of occupancy based on the number of blocks they define, the type of occupancy they define in the plan, and it will redirect and it will scrutinize all those rules. That's our plan of this scrutiny engine. So this output we are generating, if anyone is wrong, we are not generating the DCR number so that the applicant can't enter that application DCR number for application process. That's how we restrict it. So that number once generated, then it's not mean that I need to use it immediately. See, I, in this use case, example, I created everything. If all the rules are correct, I may change my area again and I can scrutinize again. This time also it may accept because I just modified some more slight changes, and stakeholder will decide later which is the final one which I need to use, and he will use that application number for application process. So that's the overall plan. That's a major difference with other our partners, sorry, competitors, and our software. Upfront, as a stakeholder, I'll get the overall picture of whether my drawing is scrutinized with all the rules or not, and he will decide which drawing final one we need to submit for the next process. This is the, that's how we design. So any confusion here, any doubts? We'll go further now after that. So what is this? How it is extracted? This part, everything. We'll go further. So I want to hear from the architects who are all attended here today, architect or who's CAD expert here.
Pradeep sir, hello.
Yeah, Shivavala.
Yeah, as of now, like Shankar sir was telling, like the entire demo of how it is, how the architect is uploading, and how the verification process, who are all the officers who are involving in this approval process and all, he told, like, correct? No?
Correct.
So I have wondered, like, whether these processes are controlled by private sector or like government will approve.
You are talking about the approval of what application?
Yeah,
or
yeah.
You're talking about?
Because it's in each municipal, they are the like ownership of for approval or verification, or at each stage that field NOC verification and fire NOC verification. Because he was showing the demo, like how it is overview of the flow right from
correct.
The start to end, right? No?
Correct.
So individual departments will involve and they will be giving the approval, right?
See, come to NOC is a different use case. I'll come to that. Okay. So
no,
NOC.
No.
Other.
What I'm asking is, architect will be uploading the drawing in DXF. Correct. No? So one uploading, the concerned municipal team will be having some officers, or their individual department will be logging in as an document verifier, field inspector. Like many logins are there. No. They will be playing the role and they will be having the authority to provide the final result, like getting up.
Correct.
Yes, my understanding is right.
Correct.
No, so he just how he got the various login as he was demonstrating, Shankar sir.
This is a test server, Shiva.
Okay, okay.
See, assume that, okay, you have a city, okay, it's a Chennai. Chennai, when we are configuring the first time, we know what is the flow actually. First, we need to decide that. So what is your flow? When my application is coming to your application system, manually also same thing, right? When you're submitting physically a hard copy to a clerk, what happens next? It may go to 5-step or 6-step. You are configuring that in the system. It should go to my its field inspector. It should go to my AE. It should go to AEE. It should go to SC. And then some places in the middle, I need to pay the fees. And then I'll get the permit. This is the flow overall. Okay.
So
that we need to configure for each city actually based on the requirement. Okay.
So one city.
Yeah.
Then after getting our result, how it is taking, how it is fetching, how the scrutiny engine it is like extracting the data from the DXF file and how it is producing that plan and all that layout and all you are emphasizing, right?
No, it's a ulta. See, the point is, tell me if it is I'm wrong. See, the first what you're doing is, as an architect, you are logging to our system. You are doing your own scrutinies of drawing multiple times. Okay.
Okay.
So finally, let's think for me. I come up with my plan. I'm saying, okay, construct me a house. What you will do is you are preparing your own drawing. Okay. But here we need our own standard set of layer names and color coding that we'll discuss further now. Okay. Using you are
as an individual, let us say if I'm I am from Tamil Nadu, I wanted to get a building plan approval, means I should follow like Tamil Nadu manual, like what are the layers, color codes. So I should draw in a manner like what are the basic community, basic things they are put it in their manual as a standard. So I will be following them. So automatically from those data, these results will be reflected, correct?
Example, let's think that I'm showing a diagram. Okay, when I'm coming to you, asking you to construct something, what I'm doing is I'm just adding some set of values here. What I'm doing, I'm just showing this is your floor design. This is your elevation, your section plan. What is your floor plan? What is your plot boundary? Everything I'm marking in one drawing. Let's assume this is a drawing I prepared for your building. And I'll show you, okay, this is the drawing I prepared. Is it fine? This is the first floor, you will get this much area. Those kind of things you will show. Once this is ready, example, now there is a chance like you are supposed to use this drawing to upload to a system, whether it is a Tamil Nadu, whatever drawing system they are scrutinizing. Let's example, if it is a software, Chennai, they have their own system, software. Similar to that, but they are asking you to follow their standard. They will say, okay, when you are using my system, you need to follow some standard. Similarly, we need some standard layers on top of this, actually, that we'll discuss. But I'll just give you 2 more minutes, like what is the overall plan is. You are using, you are logging to our system, you are scrutinizing this drawing multiple times by submitting. Example here, I just logged in as a stakeholder and I'm keep on submitting multiple drawings and I'll check myself whether my drawing is satisfying all my building rules of Tamil Nadu or not by selecting the city. So if city has also some rules, it is automatically applicable. And once everything is correct, the final drawing you will submit for the application process. What happens when I am submitting the application to the final process? That will go to the concerned city and that user will check everything, whether everything is document-wise, it's correct or not. He will go for the inspection. He will go for the next level approvers. He will internally do NOC processes. See, as a part of EODB application, they clearly says you submit in one application in one place and you take the permit. Okay. We missed one more use case. As per the latest bylaws, it says if the building is low risk kind of building, you no need to give anything. What you need to do is immediately on payment of the first stage itself, you can download the permit. That's the requirement. Right?
Yeah.
So, Shivam, is it clear actually? So the drawing you can scrutinize 10 times, but using the final drawing number, you're submitting the application. Once the submitted application, it will go further for the concerned city for next level process. That's the design.
Yeah. Okay.
So come to Tamil Nadu, their requirement is, you guys also need the similar requirement. Only you need a particular scrutiny, you should allow for that user to do multiple times and let him finalize what is the final drawing number which he wants to submit in your internal system. He will use that number and he will submit the application.
Okay.
So later what happens is there it will left to the city how they configure the workflow. We have some use cases like up to 200 meters. What we are doing is only two-level workflow. Directly do inspection and approve it. Maybe if it is from 300 to 500 meters of area of applications, I can go with two-level or three-level workflow. If it is more than 500 or based on the occupancy, I can decide different type of workflows. The workflow you can configure based on your requirement. Okay, example, okay. It's a commercial, I need a different set of workflow. Okay.
For this particular scrutiny engine software, you are the developer and owner. Again, this has to be like approved by concerned municipal. Whether we should like we can go for any software, any scrutiny software.
See, it's not any scrutiny software here. That we'll discuss now. That what is our standard? It is. That's why we are discussing, right? It's not any scrutiny software. If you're using Digic ADCI surveys, what are the tasks we need to follow that we are deciding now? We're discussing. Okay.
Okay.
So, but you got the overall picture, right? Like how drawing you're submitting, what we are checking, and what is the output we are getting as of now?
Yeah, yeah. That is clear.
Okay. Don't worry about application part, how it go further in the city level. We just give an idea like how end-to-end system works. Okay. Once the drawing is correct, you submitted the drawing, it should go. So there is no corrections we are allowing multiple times. Other system, what happens, they are allowing multiple time correction. The reason is they made some mistakes in the drawing, or maybe rules are bifurcating or it's violating all those cases. In our case, it's not like that. Upfront, it will check all the bylaws based on the type of occupancy what you define. And we are showing, okay, this everything is perfect and we are pushing for the final approval.
Okay.
If he wants to correct it again, it's a fresh application. You need to submit again and it will go again. New process again.
I just wanted to ask this for my sake, like your own team will have any architect engineer who is very well versed in drawing these kind of related to manuals and all, so that it will be easily approved at a first shot.
So we initially, when we started this process of progress, we started with Koi Code actually. The Koi Code, we have some, the team they help actually, they are developers, means they are town planners actually, two, three guys. We sit with them and we design this product actually.
Because
based on their,
if you are the people who is controlling the software, parallelly inline, that architect should, architect drawing also, it should correlate with the software, right? So they will be, if it is like, you people are in a good rapport, then definitely result will be in, it won't take much time. No?
Shiva, what we'll do is we'll discuss this point in the second one. Okay, I'll explain you the what we design now and what is the work is required first to make this work. Okay.
And
I'll give you more idea about that because once you listen all the end to end, right, you will get more idea actually what we need to do.
Okay,
we'll further proceed actually. So, I'll, as per schedule, we need to talk about layering and color coding. So, as a system, currently it supports these many features, okay? In a particular drawing, we are just looking, these are all features. Example, setback, coverage, distance from road, surrounding road, mezzanine floor, parking. It's a big list. Around, we just added major, you consider each one as a feature, okay? Example, waste disposal, solar, solid waste management, liquid treatment, segregation of toilet, waste, sanitation, leak waste. Oh, okay. These are the, you consider it as a different features required in a system. Out of that, few may require, few may not require for some set of planning, so some set of drawing. Example, when I'm constructing a small building, I may not need parking or regulations, maybe. Those kind of things we have. Maybe solar is not necessary for smaller building. It will not go through that, but it will check whether it is applicable or not. Each feature wise will go through this, and we are coding for everything. As I come to a point of coder, each these whatever we listed, this 51, 52, it may increase actually based on state to state. Each one we need to modify, which we need to configure in the system as per your Tamil Nadu building bylaws. This is one. First, what we did is we identified these features. The second point here is the layer name and standard coding structure. So the system, when we are defining, as I showed the result also, we defining into a set of plans actually. Like there will be a multiple blocks in the system. And in each block in the sense, the entire house, okay, in each, let's consider as apartment. So in each block, you may have multiple floors. By default, you can consider independent house also. When you're constructing three-floor building, we'll consider it as a one block, okay? So in that block, there may be a multiple floors. And for each floor, we have a defining a number of polygons. What does that mean is, in my first floor itself, I have two units. I may have two houses. Out of that, one house is maybe a residential, one house may be a commercial, or both may be a residential building. So that we are drawing in the diagram using a different polygon. Okay. And there are something called a level concept in our system. We'll discuss further about level concept. What is this level means? Okay. So we use some, can you share me that PDF what we generated?
That down there only below is here.
Okay.
Scroll down. The development control, that confidential. We already opened. Next. Next tab, you have no the confirm sheet. There it is.
Hmm?
The development control regulation. Not yet, confirm.
Oh, got it.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Thank you. So, what we here, see, there are two understand. See, example, this is a diagram, right? So, in this diagram, Shiva, what we are doing is, let's think, this is a drawing. When you're drawing, this is at the zeroth layer. Okay, if I'm removing this, it's a zeroth layer. One more thing, this is the drawings format. What we are uploading is a DXF style format. It's a drawing exchange format. This is this example I'll show you. And
that is fine.
As a developer also, I'm giving some idea. See, if this is my drawing file which I uploaded, okay? If I open this in editor, so this is kind of, the file content is like this. It has some DXF standard format kind of keys it is there, okay? The same key, if you open, I open the same drawing here, okay? When I open the same drawing, it looks like this. Okay? So this is a format of .dxf where normal CAD drawings will be in .dwg format, and our system supports only open source softwares. So for that open source software, what we did, we are saving this drawing in the .dxf file. It's similar to your XLS file you are saving as XLX 93-2003 Word formats, right? Similarly, in the CAD also, you have an option to save drawing to .dxf files, okay? So this can be, see, I'm using LibreCAD, it's in, I'm using Ubuntu system, it's a open source. So if I want to open the drawing file, either I need CAD software, all those things. But it's an open source drawing format, I can open using any open source tools. Even I can open the CAD if you have a CAD license, that's a different thing. But the goal here is we are trying to save money to all the architects who is using it's not necessary that I need any version of latest version of AutoCAD, all those things. No, if you have any older or if you have any open source tools, you can design this drawing using the your CAD drawings. Second one is, as an employee, example, I'm in an official, I want to open what the application is submitted. So I can see that drawing directly using these kind of open source tools, actually. It is not necessary that as a city official also, you need to buy a CAD license to open these drawings as an official. So we are trying to resolve those issues, okay? One, so now, what architect will do is, on top of this diagram, example, I'll just remove everything. See, we have something called different naming convention here. There is something called, they are call it as a layers, okay? You need to mark each layer on top of the existing diagram. That's what we are expecting from the architect to do. What he will do, he will, example here, this is my covered area. There's something called plot boundary. What it means is, in this plot, this is my building structure. This is my building, okay? So this is my front setback. This is my rear setback. There is some side setback, 1, 2. Like this. What he is doing here is, I have a plot boundary. I just opened only those layers. So on the existing drawing, if you open, this is my existing drawing. On the existing drawing, I'm just marking where is my plot boundary, where is my building, what is my front setback, what is my rear setback. Like this, we need to mark on top of the existing drawings. This is the architect work he need to follow. But what we expected is, we following some layer name standards. It's not mean that when he is marking a covered area, he can't simply mark it as a covered area. Because these layer names are important for system to understand what is the naming conventions we are following is also very important. If I have a two block. Okay,
based on the layer names, you are extracting the data from drawing, right?
Correct. Okay. So these we defined, as I show you, the 50-60 feature. For each feature, if you want to mark in the drawing, you need to use some standard layer names and color coding standards. Okay. This is one of the example I showed you. Similarly, we'll go further actually. There are so many layers like this. When the architect draw their drawing also, they are internally defining this kind of layer only. Therefore, plot boundary, they have their own naming conventions, all those things. What we're asking them to do is just use this layer standards and you mark it. Example, when I am defining my build-up area of the ground floor, there's no cellar. See, there is something called, observe here, -1, floor 0, floor 1. We'll discuss this. But this is a convention he's using. Example, my build-up area of the ground floor is showing somewhere here. This means this is my floor 0 build-up area. This is my first floor build-up area. Okay, he's marking all these things. See, if I open my entire building, it will show like this. This is my overall plan. This is my road. This is my plot. And these are my floor plan. In that, say I'm just removing. On the existing drawing, he is marking these layer names. Okay? We'll come to further discussion now. Like, what are the standard and how easy it is actually? So it's not so easy to remember all these layer names and color coding, right? What we did is, we defined one standard template format, actually, okay? The template is, it looks like this. The template is looks like this. See, Shiva, we have a property. It's a DXF file. Also, we can convert this. What we planned is there is a DXF file we're preparing, where we're just marking all the features, layer names, and we are just marking what level it is: ground, first, second, and we are using a match property concept actually. After doing everything using this file, so this is in PDF actually, it is not the exact format. The DXF file with color coding, everything is there. Then on match property, what it will do is it will rename this particular layer name and color coding with this particular layer name actually. Okay. So okay. I want to hear from you actually.
Yeah, yeah.
You got the point, right? You know that you're aware of this, right? That's what architects will do actually.
Yeah, correct. So, each and every like futures, you will be creating a block, and each and every block will be having some separate layers. So you are consolidating everything into your single abstract, and you are maintaining this format like template.
Correct. So that template you need to modify as per your requirement based on what features required, all those things here.
Okay.
So if you do match property, automatically it will use that color code and that layer name in the concern field actually. That's the overall plan. So what are the standard names we are following is we'll discuss further now. So what we are doing is, as you saw that, there are something called block underscore. Okay, why it is required is when you're defining a particular building, I just need this layer standard saying that block underscore one underscore covered area. But some places we are using this floor concept also. Why it is required? These are all at the block level. The entire block covered area you are defining, but here buildup area when you are defining, each floor level you are defining. Okay, so here the block one, floor zero, what is the buildup area? Block one, floor one, buildup area. The meaning is the ground floor buildup area, in the block one, first floor buildup area, in the second floor buildup area, we are defining like this. If any deductions required, like you want to, there are bylaws says, just don't show the lift area or those kind of things. We are showing the deduction also in the system that we are marking the deductions in the same layer. So minus one is nothing but we are using it for cellar. If you want one more cellar in the minus one, minus two, minus three means there are three underground cellars are there. Zero is the ground floor. One, two, three is the structure we followed. Okay. But observe here, there are few things we are defining. Block one, DR ramp one. So the point here is I have not defined any floor concept here. Directly I'm saying the meaning is in the block one, this is a DR ramp one. So there may be a multiple DR ramps in a particular block. I'm defining like this. If I have multiple blocks, I'll go with block one, block two, block three like this. So this is the concept we use here. The block one, floor one, buildup area like that. Another, similar syntaxes, block one, covered area, bath, water closet, this kind of thing. And there are something which is, there is no block concept, like example, plot boundary. When I'm defining my plot boundary, overall, so the my naming convention is like this. This is my plot boundary. So that plot boundary, I'm just directly using. The reason is, these are the entire building level. So there is some overhead electric line, waste disposals, all these things directly we are using with the same naming conventions. Come to the color coding, we gave our own set of color codings now. So how to identify? Example, when I'm marking my ground floor, first floor, in the ground floor itself, I have residential plus commercial. How to identify is a question now. What we are doing is when you're defining this area, buildup area, we are expecting it should be marked in residential in different color, commercial in different color like this. Okay. So this color coding is also important to extract. When I'm extracting in the ground floor, if I'm getting two areas of two different color code, the system will automatically detect based on the color code only. Okay. The color code one means residential. Example, in this case, commercial is eight. So that's the output we are showing in the output, saying that, okay, out of 800 meters. So this is what we are showing here in the residential ground floor, 44 meters, What is the carpet area, floor area? Similarly, I can show multiple occupancies also. Okay, it's a commercial, industrial, like that. In the same floor, if I have multiple occupancies, we are clearly showing each area-wise how much area is there in each block. Okay, that we are extracting using the color coding standard. So this color coding is not required in all the use cases, but going further, we'll explain where all it is required. Example here, I don't want my plot body to be in gray, green or blue. I don't want. Only when comes to floor area deductions, in these use cases only color coding matters. Otherwise, we are not worried about how you define your plot area, covered area. You can use any color codings. But wherever applicable, you need to use that color coding standard. Okay. The second one is in the system also, we have different other things. Yes, as per plan, we need some break actually. You want break or we'll continue?
You can continue, sir. Alone.
Okay, fine. So other things what we are using in the system is these kind of drawings. Like there will be a line, there is a dimensions. We are using polylines, circles, arc, okay. As of now, arc we are not supporting because our cases are rare. If you are drawing the arc using polyline, it supports, okay? So line, dimension, polyline, circle. Okay, these are the four use cases. So all drawing what you're looking here, right? These are all polygon, polylines. Okay, these are all, they are multiple polylines, okay. The system, we added some intelligence in such a way that like in case of front yard, so this is my front setback, okay. When I'm defining my front setback, automatically system should calculate what is the minimum distance from your permit, okay. Here, the system will automatically calculate, nowhere we declared what is the dimension, what is the shortest distance from my plot boundary to my building. So how we are calculating the minimum distance is, the front setback is in this use case, from my building to my footprint. Example, this is my front setback, right? So this is my plot. This is my plot. And this is my building. So when I'm saying this is my front side, the minimum distance, I'm just looking the minimum side which touches from my plot boundary to the building area. This system will automatically calculate. Nowhere I will declare what is the dimension here. Okay. But there are some use cases we need dimension. Example, when I'm marking the distance from the well. Okay. When is, I don't think it's, we have well here. Okay. Well is there. If the distance from my well to the building, here we are not automatically calculating. Here the user will define if any distance is required. The distance from the well, he will mark from what is the distance from the building to this using the dimension. So dimension is required in some places. In some use cases, we are using internally color code for dimension. Example, I want to identify what is the width and height. So I'll ask them to declare width in one color code one, height in color code two. Only in those use cases, again, color code comes into picture. Okay. Other than this, color code is required only in some, as I said, in the build-up area use cases, as well as dimension to mark, actually. And this is the template we are using. We added all these things, actually, here. What is required, we just documented here. And also, in each document, what is the layer name we used? And what you need to define also, we define. Example, if when you're defining a stay, how to define also, we mentioned actually. And that's why we are shown when you're defining dimension, length, width, which color code you need to use. And those all details we documented here. So take this example, so distance from the building to road. We need a dimension in this use case. distance from setback, we need a dimension. The system will not automatically calculate, but we'll use, there may be multiple dimensions. In a the distance from building to the main road, there may be a multiple dimensions make it, that you need to define actually. So the system will internally decide what is the shortest distance among them, and we'll use that to identify the height of the building. Okay. So these are the this is architect point of things. Actually, he need to go through all these things, and he need to come back, Shiva especially. That we define everything, what you need to define, how to define in each polygon. As a developer, what you are expecting is, example, when he is defining a footpath, when we are extracting, you will get a polyline. That's important. So the polyline, when we are extracting, there are different color codings, everything. Example, there may be, take this example. There is a public footpath or private footpath. How I can identify is based on, again, inside when you're marking that dimension itself, I can give color code. Okay, and based on that, if you have any validation, if it is a public footpath 5 meter distance from the building, private footpath 3 meters from the building, that validations will configure in the coding level, coding or configuration level. Okay, but you will get this input from the stakeholder. What are the rules after the Tamil Nadu that you need to configure? Okay, so. Yeah, any confusion, any doubts here, guys, till now? You guys are getting some, at least some ideas, developers. I want to hear from you, actually.
Yeah. How we are configuring the rules and all?
We'll discuss that. Rule part, okay. See, the plan is, okay, I'll explain the overall plan. Today, we'll discuss about only architect, all these kind of things, how to define, how to extract the rules, how to standardize these, all those things. Today, full day is like this. Tomorrow, as per plan, we'll discuss further about how to configure it actually in the system, okay, as a coding part, okay? And how to set up that also, is from tomorrow onwards, it's purely technical part, okay? How we define, how we need to code, how to configure everything, we'll discuss tomorrow. And Monday, again, you need to set up that in your local machine, how to set up that end-to-end, how it works. You can start working directly using the coding itself.
Sure.
Okay. So that's a Monday's plan for setup, all those kind of things on Monday. Tomorrow we'll discuss about coding part fully, end-to-end technical. Today we'll discuss about general, how these rules we finalize, how to define, how to extract the rules from the your building bylaws, those kind of things we'll further discuss today.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah, any doubts here, guys? Shiva?
No, sir, I got it.
You got it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll continue. Okay. The second point is, like, we have something called plan info. Okay. There is a plan info layer. So what we are doing in the plan info layer is, this is the place where we are doing okay, this is an M text. Okay, so what we did is we have some declaration part here in this layer. What architect will do is, see, this is my plan info layer name. The content of this is, I just added some set of values here. Out of that, some are, this part is there, right? These are all declarations. And some are some information. You remember, right? So first, as you observed, we are not captured anything from the UI, but I can print my district, mohalla, plot area, all these kind of things in the system. How it worked is using this plan info layer. So we have some set of parameters we defined here. And based on that, I decided my output actually here. on the top part, this part as well as my drawing part, declarations. Why it is required is, why we added like this is, like there are, take one of the example, like NOC from the neighbor. So there are bylaws, in some bylaws, what we observed is, you, if you are not giving any setback of the right side of your building, but you need to take, you can do that, but you need NOC from your neighbor. If NOC of the neighbor is not giving, you can't, you have to give some space on that side also. Okay. Now the point is, if you're submitting NOC, then my rules are different. I no need to validate whether my backside or rear side, whether any space he left or not. Minimum is 2 meters, let's assume. I don't want to check that condition only if he provided an NOC from his rear side person. So somewhere he need to declare. So drawing, when I'm scrutinizing, it's not mean that every time, one time, let's think if I give this in the UI, what happens? I may select sometime yes, sometime no. But this, everything will happening in the drawing itself, so that tomorrow, so he can't cheat us actually. Whatever the content of the drawing, using that we scrutinize. Okay, so that's what we declared here. Example, whether you are near to the airport, we just give near to the monument, or near to the government building. This, we just give a declaration. You can mark it as yes, no, not applicable, all these kind of parameters. Okay, and this is dynamic. Okay, you can add any number, any new fields also as a developer if you want. Tomorrow, example, I need some other parameters here. Okay, is next to drainage. Okay, that we are not added here. So I just need to declare whether I'm next to the drainage or not. If yes, if you declare, then the consent rules, you need, what is applicable, that you will decide in the backend. But as a plan info, it's mandatory to add those things. And you can ask them to mark it mandatory also. Okay. So plan info is very, it's majorly, we are capturing this layer with the plan that, okay, only declaration part we'll use, as well as some set of values also. Example, what is the depth of the plot? The depth of the plot, you can't show that in the diagram. Sometime, that's why we are collecting it as a value in the UI. Because the, but we are showing this is in the output. You declared that your plot depth is this, width is this. Okay. In some cases, we need MOUSA-wise. MOUSA-wise, why it is required is, maybe I have some my own set of rules for this kind of MOUSA or area-wise or anything. In Koykod, we have, in Bihar, we found this issue. There are area itself as old area, new area. In case of Pondicherry, also like that. There's a French area, there's a Tamil area, like that. They have a different rules for each type of area. So what we can do is, we can declare those area types in this plan info. So I'll just say it's just a Tamil area. The rules of Tamil area is different, French colony is different. Okay, and using this parameter, I'll apply my rules based on in the plan. Okay. This is one. So plan info is very important. It's a declarations plus this kind of information which we can't show in the drawing. We can take here and we can use rules application. We can apply rules for that actually. Okay. Second one is so multi-block concept and multi-occupancy costs, which we already discussed. And I want to discuss about other services also for a few minutes. And then we'll conclude, okay. So the point is, there may be a multiple block. What is multiple block is, I have multiple drawings actually in the system that I want to use in the system. What I'll do, it's a block one, block two is one concept, or some cases what happens, there is a main building and I also constructing a small outhouse for my driver house or something. There are rules based on that also, like what are the distance from one block to another block, how much distance should be there. And if you consider that small building as a accessory building, for accessory building, you have your own set of rules, those kind of things.
and you need a setback. It's not me that main building I have provided proper setback, like all the four sites I provided as per rule, but accessory building I'm not providing. Those things we are okay. So those logics, what we are doing is we are configuring in the system like that. That is a multi-block concept. So one is multi-block, multi-occupancy. As I said, how to decide the occupancy is each floor-wise, each block-wise, what are the occupancies they define. So sometimes what happens, let's think I have a two-block. One block is only residential, and front side, what I'm doing is I'm constructing a small commercial buildings. Now, when I'm applying the rules are what rules we need to, which occupancy I need to consider. That is important. It is not like that always I need to consider residential, wrong. Sometimes the most restrictive one I need to use, like flow, let's say coverage. When I'm saying coverage, what is coverage? So 65% of your land, you can construct a building in case of residential. But when it comes to commercial building, they will say, okay, you can construct up to 45%. Now, we need to use that most restrictive occupancy norm. What I need to do is I need to say only max I can construct 45% of my area as a building now. Okay, that logic should apply now. It is not like I need to use residential building bylaws. We need, in this case, especially in case of coverage or parking, all these things, once commercial comes into picture, the commercial rules will be applicable in some use cases. Okay, so that is very tricky thing actually in the system. How to decide is a very big challenge. So you can use another way as most restrictive. We need to use the most restrictive rules, bylaws based on the occupancy we need to decide. Yes, it's very important point, because when you're doing coding also, when you are defining your rule also, we need to be very careful about what happens if I have multiple combination of occupancies. Very important. And what you will decide in each feature, I showed you the 52 feature, right? In each feature, you need to decide. In each case, when I have multiple occupancy, what happens? Okay. And based on that, your rule, the permissible value, everything will change. Even though you can show it actually, residential, commercial, but your permissible value will change based on that most restrictive value. Okay. That is multi-occupancy concept. And there are different services coming to picture. There are cases like I also have a existing building, some cases. Okay, what happens in that case? I need to show my existing building and the proposed building also. Why required proposed building is, if I want to construct something, I need to clearly mention, okay, this is my existing building and this is my first floor. In that case also, we need to clearly show in the output also. Your existing building is 50 square meter, and now you are proposed to construct another 50 square meter. Now, the rules, what is applicable is important, because when you can't say only for 50, I'll apply the rule. It won't work out. When you are doing this kind of construction, you need to some set of rules. It is applicable for the entire 100 square meters again. So chances are there, like, I can't validate my setback for my old building, actually. It is meaningless because you constructed 10, 20 years back. Okay, now I am constructing something extra now. When I am asking to construct something extra, whether it is permissible within the rule limit or not, that we need to check. Okay. And there are some bylaws. Example, parking is applicable for the entire building, inclusive of existing plus proposed. Okay, floor area ratio, coverage, all these things matters with existing plus proposed building combination only we are validating the rules. But some, there may be a relaxation in other rules actually. Example, ground stripping, green stripping, those kind of things is different. But both area we need to use combined together, and we need to validate. And chances like occupancy also. Initially, only residential I provided. Now he wants to change it as commercial also. He wants to add some area. Now, my entire by combining both old and new, whether all my rules are by using the commercial bylaws, whether it is applicable or not, that we need to check. Okay, that is very important, and that validation is we are adding in the system. Okay, these are the major points, and on top of that, there are different type of permissions also they are asking. One is new construction, that's what we are trying to say here. What are the different type of services? Like it's maybe a new construction, it is a reconstruction, alteration, addition and alteration. So you can give permission for demolition also. So in some cases we need drawing permissions. Like if I'm demolishing completely, in that case I no need of scrutiny of drawing. Okay, I just need a demolition permission application you will submit, but how much area is demolished, you need to show somewhere and we can proceed further. There are different type of services. We call it as a different services for the application. There are bylaws also says there are some relaxation also. When I'm doing alteration, what happens? So ultimately, once you do any additional alteration or new construction, this information should go to the property tax system so that they should increase his property from that day particular onwards, added some more additional area. So that's the ultimate integration part actually. Okay. And there are some set of properties we need to finalize in the system, like what is high res. Some definitions are important when you are doing any coding also. There are bylaws says, okay, if it is a small plot buildings or single family residential building, there are some relaxation in the rules. What is single family residential? What is multi-family residential? How to decide single family residential is important. There are some use cases, say it's a small plot buildings, then there are some relaxation. There are some scheme-based rules are there. If my road width is 5 meters, and if you are applying your building permission under in this scheme, there are some relaxation. These we'll discuss further, how to normalize these and give as a input to the system, that we'll discuss in the second half, okay? But the point here is we need to identify all these things by reading the rule book, and we need to convert this into the building bylaws in the EDSS scrutiny actually. Okay. I'm going to tell one more point. You know, do you want to add anything which I miss?
Nope.
Okay. This is that's what the rules are. There are some rare use cases will come, like when they are doing road widening. What happens is, in those cases, the distance from the there is some relaxation in the setback or relaxation in the floor area ratio they will provide. So all these things are some use cases will come when you're coding your rules actually. So it's not so easy to configure also to handle all these use cases. As I said, there is a scheme wise, and moreover, one more use case is amendments. Amendment, what happens is it's very important. When you're coding, we need to make it say some standard. Like today I'm applying, okay? So they're saying solar is not mandated, but ultimately, once I get permission today, I need to construct within a permission limit of 3 years or 5 years based on the building bylaws. Once I constructed my building, I'm supposed to get the occupancy certificate later point of time. What is occupancy certificate before entering to the house? This OC in some states is mandatory. Okay, if you want electricity, everything, you get the OC first and then come back and apply for the water and sewerage, everything. In that case, what happens again, he will go through again same plan, saying that initially I plan to construct 100 meters. Now I constructed 105 meters. What happens? Okay, here it's again state will decide. There is some limitations. They'll give some relaxation in 5 meters relaxation or 10 meters, so 10% or 5% relaxation. There some rule says, okay, if it is more than 5%, within 10%, let him pay the difference of 5 meters. 5% amount and we'll give OC. But in some states, it's very strict. They will say, okay, no. Exactly, if you are asking for 100 meters, you need to construct 100 meters. And based on that, they will give OC. But here, the rules, what we are scrutinizing again the second time, it should match with the rule, actually. It's not mean that by increasing my some area, it should not violate my parking rules or anything else. It should pass everything. And there is, if fees is a relaxation is there, by paying the fees, that also we need to check. Okay. But rules, what we are scrutinizing, right? These rules are as on the date when he took the permission. I'm repeating, it's very important. Let's think tomorrow, if Tamil Nadu, they amended, saying that from tomorrow onwards, whoever is constructing solar is mandatory in all the houses of residential. But I already took permission today. When I'm applying OC, mandatory of that solar should not applicable for that. The reason is, when you are issuing me the permission, as per those rules only I constructed, and any relaxation, tomorrow if they may say, okay, I don't want solar now onwards, but it is not applicable. As on today, if rule says it solar is applicable, that will applicable on OC also when you are applying. The same rules, set of rules we need to check in the system. Developers, this is very important. When you are coding, keep this also in mind. In future, when you are maintaining the code.
Okay.
Very, very important, because if you modify something as on particular date, date-wise, we need to scrutinize the rules in that case. Okay. Amendments are not frequently happens, maybe 6 months once, yearly once, all those things. But each city, if they have their own some set of things, then it's a problem. We'll discuss further how to how the rules will define and how to do that. Those kind of things, how to extract the rules, or we have some template formats for that. And those things we'll discuss in the second half. Okay. This is overall. See, I just try to give you the overall picture of the system. Okay. It's not look simple, but there are complexities also there. And if you miss one simple logic, actually, it will break everything. Okay. When we are coding also, we need to be very careful when you are configuring. And we need different set of drawings. The problem with this is we need different set of drawings. Okay. When my building is more than 100 meters, less than 100 meters, exact 100 meters, what happens? These are the three use cases. Okay. Distance from the government building. If it is more than 100 meters, there is some bylaws. Less than 100, we need to relax. If exact 100, what happens? So the checking of each feature also, you need drawing here. Okay. So it's better to add a test cases, or you need to depend on drawing, and every time you are scrutinizing and you will check your use cases actually, otherwise. Okay. So testing also very important role in this project actually. Frankly saying, if my development is 1 month, testing should be double actually. That's how it is. Because you need to check all the permutation combination of all the use cases here. The schemes, occupancies, multi-blocks, everything, okay? Yes, we'll spend another 10 minutes. If you have any doubts, any discussion, then we'll wrap it up and then we'll come back at 2:30 for further discussion in the second half.
Okay.
Shiva?
Yeah, I'm sir.
Yes, sir. Tell me. Is it clear? You got some idea now about the system, what we need to do?
Yeah. I got it, sir. This regarding this multiple occupancy, again, we have to state like for each and floor, we have to give it as a quantity, right? Then only this permissible value it will take into account.
Example, when you're defining your house, what you'll do, I'll say my ground is residential. First floor, I'm doing commercial. Whatever you are defining, right? Same thing you need to add in the drawing. Use that color code.
That will be like, exactly we can't put it, right? How many occupancy will be there for a commercial sake? If it is like own building, that is different. For commercial sake, how much occupancy will be there? We can't state it precisely, right?
You have to, right? Otherwise, you can't take any permission. Example, if you are saying I'm commercial.
I mean,
I mean, like maximum occupancy, you have to state it there so that whatever the permissible value it will be taking, right? Let us say like in this floor, some 100 people will be assessing daily.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to give like 110 or 120 like that, or how they will be like giving the exact occupancy? I'm asking.
See, occupancy, I'm not talking about, yeah. See, there are different ways to define, okay.
So okay.
When you're constructing the building, you know that, okay, I'm constructing a 3-star hotel.
Okay.
Okay. What is 3-star hotel? It's a commercial building. Either I need to define it as a commercial building, or I can define it as a 3-star hotel. Okay. The point here is, when you are defining it as a 3-star hotel, there are chances that commercial rules plus there are 3-star hotels rules are applicable for the drawing.
Okay.
Okay. So that is very important. When you are constructing something, if mm-hmm. you clearly specify what is your, we call it as a sub-occupancy, okay? Your bylaw says, okay, if when you are constructing a 3-star hotel, minimum is 2,000 plot area is required.
Okay.
That to do that validation, you have to define what kind of commercial you are doing.
Okay.
If you are constructing a wedding hall, the wedding hall minimum area is 8,000 meters. You can't declare it as I'm just doing a commercial building, meaningless. Mm. But if you clearly specify, because the concerned rules also will validate, minimum 8,000 square meter area is required. The road width of this should be minimum 30 meters. Why it is required? Because otherwise it will become too crowded.
That's general, like bylaws, it is mandatory, sir. I understood completely, like any architecture building, either it is structural or RCC, as per like rule, it depends upon the soil or survey report, investigation report, this much load it can bear, this much of tensile and yield strength it will bear, like that and all, each floor level or else each building it will possess. That is a building basic bylaw. What criteria? This multiple occupancy, why it is like you are specifically concerned about, I wanted to know. That's why.
Yeah, because your rules are different, right? I gave one of, see, you brought one more nice point, actually. We are not doing any structural.
Why it is coming into the picture, I was thinking, like occupancy doesn't matter, right?
I'll explain. See, one thing, you brought a nice, one more missing point. We are not doing any structural scrutiny here, okay? Second one, we're doing only building bylaw scrutiny using this system. One. Sorry. And everything is, we have some standards. It should be in meters. It should be in 1:1 scale. Those things, some standards, they need to define in the drawing. Okay, then only automatically I can auto-measure the dimension, what he declared. I can measure the height, what he declared. Those kind of things.
Correct.
One. Second one, here, as you said, it's structural things, we are not worried, okay? But we are looking only building bylaws. Mm-hmm. Second one, this occupancy is very, very important, because when you're saying residential or commercial,
okay,
I need to show you in the drawing also, like overall picture, like how much area you are asked for residential building.
Mm-hmm.
Occupancy
for
matters.
For the sake, you, any commercial building you can state, or also any example you can give, so that I can... Example, particular example, whichever it is matching.
Okay, let's take ground floor. You are restoring. You are fully constructing commercial. Second, 2-3 floors. You are constructing residential. Okay.
Okay.
So in this case, what happens? Now your coverage. Example coverage. Coverage. It says only 45% for commercial. 65% for your residential building. That's the rules. Now, what you will do actually, if both are combined together?
Uh-huh.
What is your bylaw says actually? Let's think I want to construct my building. Ground floor is commercial. That's a common thing actually. Ground floor, I'll do commercial if I am a corner site. First and second, I want to be myself. I want to be a residential building. What is your bylaw says about coverage? How much I can construct?
Again, based upon that, that contract value and...
Let's think commercial says 45, say residential says 65. If you're not declaring occupancy, what happens?
You tell me, sir. You tell me.
No. You are architect, right? You are doing drawings.
Okay.
When you're doing drawing, sorry, I didn't get your overall picture. Are you doing any drawings also for buildings? You have a lot of experience?
I'm not a pure architect who having experience in building domain, but I have like knowledge of in structural and AutoCAD. So I'm not into particular what you call architect.
Anybody is there in this group who knows, who can take these decisions? This is very important. That's what we said in the last meetings also. Anybody else also joined, or you are the alone architect in this group, today's training?
Vimal, Vijay?
No architect, except Sarvalan, no one is.
Okay. Shivam, why we are saying is, this entire project is depending on the person who is taking the decision. As I just asked you one question, right? Occupancy.
Yeah.
These decision taking guy is required who can decide, okay, in this combination, what happens?
Mm-hmm.
It's a common requirement. I'm not asking any complex things. It's a simple use case.
My point is very clear. Like, it is a permutation thing. It is a, we can't say it is exactly this much, these many of occupancy will be there in first floor. Like that, I'm asking whether we have to put it as tentatively or what else. I don't have any idea. That's what I'm asking.
Sir, it's Shiva, it's definitely required.
After drawing, let us say, if particular area, if I'm designing on building, if I'm designing some length, width, and all, and height based upon the ratio of the building, or I can construct the building. I can tell you like these much of strength it can bear. Either the strength it is converted to occupancy, weight, or pound, water, maybe. Okay.
Strength is different. Okay. First of all, if you don't have permission to construct, what's the point of strength to check?
Correct. So it comes into picture like for permission cadre, occupancy, you have to mention.
Correct. So that's very important, actually. You can't design something which is 100% coverage. You not mean that you have 30-40 site 100% in that. Without giving setback, you can't consider, right?
Whether this multiple occupancy, whatever we are mentioning in the drawing, it will impact at the future after the building is physically erected?
See, when you are taking permission, it's very important that based on that only your property tax will decide, and your occupancy, you already declared that, okay, this is what I'm constructing. There are, we'll further discuss in the second half, okay, there are some zonal regulations comes into picture where it clearly mentions only these kind of occupancy is only allowed in this kind of zonal regulations. And there is some restrictions for that. Definitely, we need to define the occupancy. Otherwise, you can't decide all these things. As I said, coverage is one simple example. If I have multiple occupancy, what is my logic is important. Right?
Understood. Okay, I got it.
Got it, right?
A fee calculation also is matters. So based on occupancy type, the fees will be calculated. So at the time also occupancy matters. Okay, you need to define occupancy.
Based upon occupancy, what it is calculated?
Fee also. Fee, permit fee, or the property tax also. When you calculate in the property tax also, based on the occupancy type, the fees is varies. Because for residential it's 10 rupees per square meter. For commercial it's per square meter 15 rupees, like that. So at that time, for how much area for residential, how much area for a commercial, that you need to define it.
Yeah, understood. Right.
Any queries? Any other queries you have?
No, sir. I got it.
Okay, in second half, we'll further discuss about, we'll go with rules, template, and how to do that, everything further, okay?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, we know 2:30, right?
Yeah, brother, 2:30.
Okay, guys, we'll meet up after lunch. 2:30, we'll discuss further, okay?
Okay.
We'll go further how to we'll go with some rules also. Shiva, I need some presentation from your side also. What rules, what you plan for Tamil Nadu and those kind of things actually. Okay.
That DGR rule book is like, we have that TN manual, it is there. There they given all kind of like...
Shiva, sorry to interrupt, this is Karthik. Pradeep, we have a few scenarios with the rules we have collected from the department that I can share you.
Thanks, Karthik. It's better to go with that actually, so that they will get real idea actually. Instead of going with some blanking. Thank you guys. We'll see in 2:30 then actually.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.